I had to leave Pingry because my parents had moved from Cranford to Madison. And in those days, Pingry did not have the far-ranging bus system that it has today. When I went to Pingry, my father dropped me off on his way to work in Newark. And then I took the 4:16 train home to Cranford every afternoon, along with boys from Roselle, Cranford, Westfield, and Plainfield. And would you believe it, the airfare ticket to Cranford from Elizabeth cost 9 cents. I left Pingry after the school year ended in 1926 and entered the Madison Academy and then went away to boarding school. I didn't have any further connection with Pingry for several years until one day in the early 1950s when I was living in Summit, I took my older son Rick, who is here with us this afternoon. He was about 10 years old at that time. I took him to see the school. The Parker Road building by then was 6 decades old and in bad shape. But we visited the impressive new school that was under construction on North Avenue in Hillside, a mile or so away from the old campus. While we were looking on in wonder, who should we run into but my old friend and Pingry classmate, Charlie Atwater, who was also looking at the construction project. He had become a successor to Arthur Varge as head of the middle school and in due course became headmaster. Pingry's new Hillside campus, of course, had a gymnasium. But within the first few years, it became evident that it was not adequate. And a second gym was added. The dedicatory remarks for the new gym were given by my cousin, Kim Whitehead, one-time captain of Pingry's football team and in the Pingry Athletic Hall of Fame. He was also my Yale classmate, Yale football captain, and a member of the famous 1934 Ironman. Rick entered Pingry shortly after it opened for business in the new Hillside location. He was there for 6 years before going away to Andover, where I too had gone. Our second son, John, who's also here this afternoon, followed, attending Pingry for 7 years before going to Westminster. In 1955, I was invited to become a member of the Pingry Board and greatly enjoyed my service under chairmen like Conover English and Chester Smith. I was a slow learner, but by the end of 1969, I had come to the realization that notwithstanding its beautiful new and efficient schoolhouse, Pingry was in the wrong place for the long haul. Newark Academy had already moved to a beautiful campus in Livingston and was attracting some of the students Pingry would normally have had. So I gathered up my son Rick, who was now back from a Marine Corps tour in Vietnam, and we went to see my neighbor Bob Parsons, who by then had retired or was about to retire as an elder statesman of the Pingry Board. I did so with some trepidation because Bob had been head of a foundation that did a lot of the funding for the move from Parker Road to Hillside less than 20 years earlier. And here I was about to suggest that all his excellent work should be set aside and that Pingry should move again. I gathered up my courage and told him what I thought. To my amazement, Bob took my point immediately and even proposed that we go out together to look at some possible sites. Later that winter, we drove out in the countryside near Bernardsville and Basking Ridge, looking at several pieces of land. I then broached the subject with the board, offering to buy the land if they found a piece they were interested in, and volunteered to transfer it to Pingry at my cost if it happened. To make a very long story short, there were yeas and nays, but the movers prevailed. And so we were off, but I can't add, and running. For it was a slow, torturous march, and there was much to be done. The Odd Hope Committee that pushed the move along over the years consisted of Harry Hoyt, David Baldwin, Fred Bartenstein, Max Bristol, Joe Engel, and me. Somehow, we got the task done. There were many problems. We had to deal with the city of Elizabeth, the town of Hillside, and the state of New Jersey in connection with disposing of the Hillside property. The price kept getting lower and lower until we sold it for a price that was practically a giveaway. Today, it is a part of Kane College. The prospect of a new school on the tract we found in Bernards Township led to some discussions between Pingry and the Kent Place School. We at Pingry had thought that since coeducation was inevitable, the old girls Kent Place might be interested in merging with us at the new site. In the end, Kent Place decided to remain where they were, and Pingry instead merged with Short Hills Country Day. This highly successful merger enabled Pingry to become coeducational across the board in the fall of 1974 and to establish its junior school on the old Short Hills Country Day campus in Short Hills. Out here in Martinsville, we had our groundbreaking ceremony in April 1982. At a point near where our driveway and the highway now come together. There's a photo around that shows two headmasters, Dave Wilson and Scotty Cunningham, along with Fred Bartenstein, Mac Bristol, and me, with a side lifter in the background. During construction, Fred Bartenstein was at the site and on the job practically every day working out changes with the contract. In addition, there were more municipal regulatory problems than we could shake a stick at. One of the main problems was the disposal of sewage and the need to tap into one of the nearby sewage systems. It was one thing for a farmer and his family to live on a piece of land and flush a toilet, and another for a school with about 1,000 persons to be created there. We found ourselves having to deal with the State of New Jersey Environmental Protection Agency, the planning boards of Bernards Township, Bridgewater Township, and Somerset County, the sewage authorities of Warren Township and the Somerset Raritan Valley System, and many other municipal bodies. Fred Bartenstein not only dealt with the contractors, but used his superb legal ability to work things out with all the governmental authorities we had to deal with. Finally, the new school was dedicated in May 1984, and the rest is history. But history never really ends, and the job of Pingry is never finished. Over the years, the playing fields have been substantially improved. In 2006, the new middle school was dedicated. It is called the Carroll and Park B. Smith Middle School. And today, the new headmaster's house out here on this campus is or soon will be under construction. We have out front a splendid new statue of Dr. Pingry with some students, two boys and two girls. While it is historically inaccurate, it is philosophically correct. I like that. Much has changed at Pingry since Dr. Pingry's day, but as long as there is a Pingry, the people and the means to make it better will surely appear as in our time and in the past. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill. That was a wonderful way to kick off our celebration of the 150th anniversary of the Pingry School. And you know, your comment about the last sesquicentennial that you were mentioning in 1926, one more interesting coincidence, that was the year in which the Honor Code was written by the students. So another great link there. In less than 10 days, Mr. Beinecke celebrates his 97th birthday. And I would like to invite Jay Winston to lead us in singing Happy Birthday. And Marissa Werner and Freddie Elliott have a little presentation to make. Where's Mr. Winston? Mr. Winston.
Happy birthday to you, happy birthday.